Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The topic of ilmu al-ghayb, or knowledge of the unseen, is a topic that has different viewpoints. Some go as far to say that if you claim that anybody besides God has knowledge of the unseen, then you have committed shirk, that you have committed polytheism, or that you are a disbeliever. So we want to analyze this question. Can prophets, can humans, can the successors of the prophets have knowledge of the unseen, ilm al-ghayb, or is this something exclusive to God? One of the verses, or categories of verses that we look at, there are a few verses of the Quran that say knowledge of the unseen, ilm al-ghayb, is exclusive to God. Let's look at some of these verses. وَعِنَّهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُ. With him are the treasures of the unseen. No one knows him except for him, except for God. Or فَقُلْ إِنَّمَا الْغَيْبُ لِلَّهِ. Say, the knowledge of the unseen belongs only to Allah. قُلْ لَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ عِنْدِي خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ. Say, I do not say to you that I possess the treasuries of Allah, nor do I know the unseen. So if we limit ourselves just to these verses, and we don't look at the hadith, and don't look at the sunnah, and we don't look at the other verses, it comes to, at a first glance, it comes to mind that only God has knowledge of the unseen, and that we should not claim that anybody else has knowledge of the unseen. But let's look at other verses of the Quran and have a comprehensive view of the Holy Quran. We read other verses, and it says, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَىٰ غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا إِلَّا مَنْ ارْتَضَىٰ مِنْ رَسُولٍ. Knower of the unseen, he does not disclose his knowledge of the unseen to anyone, except to an apostle he approves of. So in this verse, it has a إِلَّا, except who? مَنْ ارْتَضَىٰ مِنْ رَسُولٍ, except to an apostle he approves of. Or Prophet Isa alayhi salam in the Quran talks about وَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا تَأْكُلُونَ وَمَا تَدَّخِرُونَ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ. I will tell you what you have eaten and what you have stored in your homes. So when we put these two verses together, it seems like they contradict. So today we're going to try to get a final answer to this question. Can humans, and at the top of humanity are the prophets, can prophets and their successors, can they have knowledge of the unseen? Let's examine other things in the Quran. We see other beautiful stories in the Quran that other prophets were given knowledge of the unseen, knowledge of future events. We even see in the Quran, maybe there's about 50 verses or examples we can quote, that in the Quran, events of the future were told to people. So when we look at, for example, the story of Prophet Ibrahim's wife, Sarah, that she is informed she will have a child, and she is surprised because she says she's ajuz, she's old, and her husband is a sheikh, and her husband is old. How can they have a child? And then Allah gives them Ishaq. Or we see the example of Prophet Musa alayhi salam's mother, being informed that when she's going to put and place her child, her newborn, into the river, that eventually that son will be returned to her. So this is information, this is knowledge of the unseen that is told to non-prophets. So we see the wife of Prophet Ibrahim, Sarah, is informed. We see the mother of Prophet Musa, alayhi salam. We see in the example of Lady Maryam, for example, that she is informed that she will have a son soon. So this is information that is given, knowledge of the unseen that is given. And when you look at the Quran, you see many examples, especially the story, if you want to understand this concept, look at the story of Khidr, the companionship of Khidr with Prophet Musa alayhi salam. And you see how Khidr gives information of the future. He predicts the future of what will happen. So therefore, when we look at the Quran, we see that actually when those stories in detail and those examples as I have given, Allah has given an exception. So how can we put these two types of verses together? That is what an alim, a scholar, he puts his job is, to put two dalils, they're both from the Quran, or they're both correct, they're both sahih, and we trust both of them. How can we combine and reconcile them? One of the ways we can reconcile these two verses is to say this: God only has knowledge of the unseen, but He has an absolute knowledge of the unseen. And everything that there is to know, He knows. But us as humans, and at the maximum as prophets, those that are prophets and successors of prophets, when compared to the knowledge of God, it is still limited. We still do not know, for example, knowledge of God's essence, of His thought, or other things. So therefore, there are things that human beings just cannot be able to realize. So when we say al-ghayb, the unseen, we can say maybe it refers to this, the absolute al-ghayb, absolute knowledge of the unseen. This is one explanation. There are other explanations, for example. Another way is to say the difference between these two verses is that one talks about independent knowledge and the other is talking about dependent knowledge. The knowledge of God is independent. He does not need anybody for His knowledge. He is the source of knowledge. He is ilm. He has knowledge Himself. He doesn't need anyone for that knowledge. But even the prophets, the successors of the prophets, they need God. They are dependent of God for their knowledge. Therefore, they truly don't possess al-ghayb. God does, but they receive it from Him. The third you could say is that God's knowledge of the unseen is fa'al, is active. It occurs in all instances. He does not need to be taught. But our knowledge, even knowledge of humans, even knowledge of the prophets, is a knowledge that needs to be taught, needs to be revealed. And sometimes we have the prophets either, or the successors of the prophets, they learn it from, for example, Imam Ali alayhi salam learns it from the Holy Prophet Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, either through teachings or either through books sometimes we can have others learn. Or sometimes we can say something is inspired to them. There's ilham that is inspired to them. And there is a knowledge that is acquired that wasn't there before and then they gain it. So therefore we can say the knowledge of God is different because it's absolute, it's independent, and it's active. He knows everything all the time. And there are other differences too, we could say, but we can limit ourselves to these three things. Therefore, to put these beautiful verses of the Quran together and these stories of the Quran together, we can say that this is true. God has knowledge of the ghayb, but in that definition that we talked about, and no one has it but Him. But He can give that knowledge to the prophets, to the successors of the prophets. Brothers and sisters, this topic is so important for us to know. And if we don't understand it, we would be limiting the knowledge of the prophets, limiting the knowledge of the successors, and limiting the knowledge of holy people. Unfortunately, when you look at how the Umayyads or how the Banu al-Abbas have defined the Holy Prophet of Islam, and they have brought down his status, and you see traditions in Bukhari, for example, that the Prophet tells people in these traditions that we do not accept, that do not say I am higher than Yunus, for example, or do not say that I'm higher than Musa alayhi salam. And they bring down the station of the Prophet, even though there's ijma, that the Prophet of Islam is the highest of all prophets. He's the highest of creation. So the Umayyads and the Abbasids, because they're usurping the rights of the holy imams, they would bring down the status of the holy prophet. So much so that when it comes to even worldly affairs, normal worldly affairs, there's a tradition in Muslim Sahih that mentions that when people were grafting trees, and this was a process of that farmers would use, the Prophet says, there's no need for this. There's no need for grafting. And then the yields became less. Then the Prophet tells them in this hadith, أَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِأَمْرِ دُنْيَاكُمْ. You have more knowledge of the worldly affair than it comes to me. So you see that they have brought down the status of the Holy Prophet of Islam to a level that he has less knowledge than normal farmers. A'na'udhu billah. So we want to actually understand the maqam of the prophets and the anbiya and the imams, alayhim as-salam, how it really was. When you look at the life of al-imam al-Hasan al-Askari, alayhi as-salam, the 11th imam, the 11th successor of Prophet Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. When you understand ilm al-ghayb, and this definition that we just defined, that ilm al-ghayb is possible, but with this definition, the way that we define it, we understand that this was one of the distinguishing characteristics and circumstances that surrounded the life of Imam Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam. We see scholars, for example, Qutb al-Rawandi mentioned 40 instances where the holy Imam, where Imam Askari alayhi salam, used to inform people of future events. Or you see Sayyid Bahrani, 134 examples. Sheikh Hurra Amalin Ithbatul Huda, 136 examples. Allama Majlisi, 81 examples, occurrences where knowledge of the unseen is used. Why do you think Imam Hasan al-Askari used knowledge of the unseen? Even though the prophets had this knowledge, even though their successors have this. In general, we believe they need to have knowledge, these holy guides need to have knowledge so that they can fulfill their role as a holy Imam. One of the reasons is this. Samirra was a military zone. And there are traditions that the Imam would tell people not to point to him or not to say salam to him because the government was watching. He was under heavy surveillance and those followers would be in trouble. They would be in danger. Therefore, how is the Imam going to show his imamah? That is one of his duties. It's to show that he is the Imam of the age so they can come to him and he can guide them, or that he can guide them through their representatives, his representatives. It is through knowledge of the unseen, very short and very quickly, he would inform them of knowledge of the unseen. And we see beautiful stories, for example. You see an example in Kashful Ghumma, a story of Kashful Ghumma, that a person needed financial assistance and asked the Imam to do dua from him. Muhammad ibn Hamza writes a letter to the Imam asking for him to do dua for his financial situation. And the Imam informs him that soon you will have inheritance of 100,000 dirhams. Second, we see, for example, when it comes to a prisoner, Abu Hashim Ja'fari complains to the Imam that I'm in prison and it's difficult life under the Abbasids. Imagine being in their prisons. The Imam tells him that you'll be doing Salat al-Dhuhr in your own home today. Or we see other examples. We see Ja'far ibn Muhammad Qalanisi, who has the Imam, writes a letter to the Imam, and he has him pray for his wife. And his wife is pregnant, and he has some du'as, he has wishes, he prays to the Imam. And the Imam informs him that soon you will have twins, and name them Muhammad and Abdul Rahman. Or you see other examples, that some people, it came to an extent that this knowledge was used so much, the Shia would talk about it, the karamat of Imam Askari alayhi salam. And a Nasabi, a person that had hatred of the Ahlul Bayt, he says that this is not true. How can he have knowledge of the unseen? If this is true, I'm going to accept his walayat. I'm going to accept him as my Imam. So this Nasabi, this person that had hatred of the Ahlul Bayt, he writes a letter without ink. And this is he writes a letter without ink quoted in the books, and when he writes this letter, he writes it in a way that the Imam cannot understand without using knowledge of the unseen. The letter comes back and is answered just the way that he wrote it without ink, and he becomes a follower of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. So brothers and sisters, with our explanation that when you read the Holy Quran and look at stories of the Holy Quran, and then you look at the life of the infallibles, you see it's in line. When you read about the story of Khidr and the companionship with Prophet Musa alayhi salam, when you see the story of Prophet Ibrahim's wife, Sarah, being informed, or Isa alayhi salam informing people of what they eat, you see that this is all in line, that this is knowledge that the prophets and their successors had to tell people that they are from God, to prove to people that they are from God. And they shouldn't go anywhere else. In conclusion, I'm going to give a story, a beautiful story, of one of the Christians that came to Imam Askari alayhi salam. And this is quoted in the book Madinatu Ma'ajiz of Allama Bahrani. You see that Anush, a Christian, comes to Imam Askari alayhi salam, asking him to do dua for him and for his two sons that he had. So the Imam comes, and the Imam is stating that the Christians, or this Christian, they know more about our haq, our right, than the Muslimin. That the Imam was so oppressed in the area that he was, that a lot of the Muslims were not following Imam Askari salam, and the Christians, some of them, because they would see the miracles of the Ahlul Bayt, they would rely on them. So he comes to his house, and Anush comes. He takes off what he was wearing on his head. He takes off his shoes for a sign of respect that Imam Askari alayhi salam has come to his home. And he has come to his home now. And of course, first Anush comes to the state and informs them, and the state approves for him to take such a journey. And they allow him. And he goes, and the Imam informs him this thing, that you have two sons, one of them will soon die, but the other one will live and remain, and he will have the walayas of the Ahlul Bayt. He will become a follower of the Ahlul Bayt. And the father there, it's very difficult for him to hear this, but he says, it comforts me. Anus says, it comforts me the fact that you know that my son is going to be a follower of the Ahlul Bayt. And the narrator says there that it happened just how the Imam Askari explained, that after 3 days, that first son passed away, and after about 6 days, the other one became a follower of the Ahlul Bayt. So you see that the Imams would attract people with their knowledge of the unseen, because they did not have this Imam, holy Imam, because he did not have the circumstances that Imam al-Sadiq, Imam Baqir alayhi salam, did to teach people, to share their knowledge, that they were basically in prison under surveillance. And this was one of the methods they used to guide people. At the end tonight, we're going to mention how Imam Hasan Askari, who is a madhloom and oppressed Imam, at the age of 28, he was an Imam for 6 years. And at the age of 28, they give him poison. And this poison is such a way that when you look at the book Al-Ghaiba of Shaykh al-Tusi, you see a Shaykh al-Tusi, you see that there they give him, the holy Imam, a drink that is boiled to relieve him of his pains, to make him feel better. But it is such a way that the holy Imam's lips are shaking, his hands are shaking, the cup hits his holy teeth, and he cannot drink. This is the pain that Imam Hasan Askari Islam is having at the end of his life. Someone that is 28 years old, that he cannot even pick a cup and drink it. So he has Aqid go and bring his son. And one of the duties that Imam Hasan Askari had was to inform specific people of the birth of the savior of Islam, his son. And imagine now Imam Mahdi is coming. He's coming, he's about 5 years of age. He's coming and he has to witness his father dying in front of him. And there, Imam Mahdi comes, and Imam Askari alayhi salam sees him, and he begins to cry. Baka, it says, قَالَ يَا سَيِّدَ أَهْلِ بَيْتِ اسْقِنِي الْمَا Drink, let me drink water. فَإِنِّي ذَاهِبٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي Because I am leaving to my Lord. I'm soon going to be leaving. وَأَخَذَ السَّبِيَ الْقَدَهِ الْمَغْلِيِ الْمُسْتَكَى الْمُسْتَكِينَ يَدِهِ ثُمَّ حَرَّكَ شَفَتَيْنَ And then Imam Mahdi takes this cup and helps his father and gives him a drink of this sharb. Then the Imam says, هَيَّئُونِي لِلصَّلَاةِ Get me prepared for salah. فَطُرِهَا فِي حَجْرِهِ And then the Imam alayhi salam, Imam Mahdi helps his father. You must, as you know, you can't, wudu has to be done by yourself. And Imam Hasan Askari is so weak now, he cannot perform wudu. Imam Mahdi is helping him perform his wudu. This 5-year-old Holy Imam has to witness his father become martyr. But this wasn't the only dhulm of the Ahlul Bayt. This wasn't the only time that children had to see their father or their parents become martyr. When we go to Medina, about 200 years before this, 250 years before this about, you see that they came and attacked the home of Lady Fatima, salawatullah alayha. These children, about 5, 6, 7 years old, they have to witness, they set their house on fire. This was not the only time that the children of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they had to witness such dhulm and such oppression. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Sahib az-zaman jasliyat. Sahib az-zaman jasliyat. Sahib az-zaman jasliyat.